a miracle today. Come and do a miracle today. Destiny changer.
I want to share on a topic that I have entitled, If It Doesn't Cost You, It's Not Worth It. If it doesn't cost you, it's not worth it. And I want us to read from Genesis chapter 22. Genesis 22, we'll read from verse number 1 to verse number 19. I'm reading from English Standard Version. Can read together with me. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father Abraham, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. He said, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So they went, both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. He said, do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked. And behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, the Lord will provide. As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed because you have obeyed my voice. So Abraham returned to his young men, and they arose and went together to Beersheba. And Abraham lived at Beersheba. Let's pray for the word. We thank you, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We appreciate you for this word that we have read. Lord, I pray that as I share from this portion of scripture, you will minister to us. Dear Lord, I pray that whatever you have purpose to say today, you will say it through me. I surrender to the authority and the leading of your spirit. I pray, King of Kings, that whatever it is that you want to accomplish today, may you accomplish it to the glory of your name. As I open my mouth, I pray that the words of my mouth will be pleasing in your sight. I pray that the meditations of my heart will please you this morning. And Father, I pray that our hearts will be open. Give us a heart of flesh that we may be able to respond as you want us to respond to this word. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 I would like to begin by making some very bold and radical statements this morning. These are the statements that I want to make. One, If your life doesn't cost you anything, it is not worth living. If you are in any kind of relationship and that relationship doesn't cost you, I want to categorically submit to you this morning that relationship is not worth it. If you are married and you're in a marriage that doesn't cost you anything, you don't have to sacrifice to make that marriage work, then it is not worth it. Now, this is my own opinion. One of the reasons why marriages are breaking is because some people don't want to pay the cost that comes with marriage. There are people who want an easy path. They avoid those crucial conversations with their spouses. God commands all men, or husbands for that matter, to love their wives. Unconditional love is not cheap. Unconditional love is costly. All wives are to submit to their own husbands. Submission is not cheap. Submission is costly. If your faith doesn't cost you, if you are more than comfortable, you wake up after everyone else has woken up, the whole week passes without you spending time with the Lord, you can't remember the last time you prayed and fasted to seek the face of God and to be closer to God, you can't remember the last time you risked and witnessed to an unbeliever, then that faith is not worth living for. If your job or business or anything that you do doesn't cost you anything, that job or business is not worth it. If you are serving in any ministry, here in church or even out of this assembly, and that ministry or that service doesn't cost you anything, I would advise you to stop, because it is not worth the service. If it doesn't cost you anything, it is not worth it. Now, after making those bold statements, I feel very uncomfortable, just as some of us might be feeling right now. I don't know what our response will be, but I would have loved to use some very nice and comfortable words. But unfortunately, or fortunately, those are the most comfortable words I would use today. Now, brothers and sisters, if you are a believer, if you believe in Jesus Christ, if you're a Christ follower, if you have a personal relationship with Jesus, I would like to remind you that Christianity, or the faith that we profess, is not cheap. It is costly. This salvation is not for the faint-hearted. It's not a call to comfort. It is not a call to fun or self-satisfaction or even self-indulgence. Salvation is a call to death. Jesus calls us to come and die. We are called to die to self. We are called to die to the flesh. We are called to die to the desires of the flesh. We are called to die to the standards of the world. A man by the name Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he says that when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. So Christianity is a call to live a distinct, consecrated, and holy life set apart for the kingdom of God. It is a call to a renewal of mind and not conformation or conforming to the standards of the world. It is a call to suffering. It's a call to carrying of the cross and following Jesus Christ daily. We are called to a life of dying daily. It's a call to tough life. It's a call to live and cleave. And friends, this call is not easy. It is not easy. It is costly. Unfortunately, we have been presented with a very easy and cheap and comfortable and soothing gospel. We are told, just accept Jesus Christ and do your stuff. Accept Jesus Christ and continue loving yourself and the things that you used to do. Accept Jesus Christ and continue with your former life. There is no problem. But I want to submit to us this morning that that is not the gospel that was presented to us by Jesus Christ. It's not the gospel that was presented to us by the apostles. It's not the gospel of the Bible. The gospel of the Bible is an expensive, costly gospel. The gospel of the Bible is that salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, not any other thing. This salvation we receive freely, but it was costly. It cost Jesus his own dear life. It cost God his own one and only Son. Grace is not cheap. Grace is costly. I don't expect so many amens this morning, but I was prepared for that earlier. I want to quote again from this man called Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He says, "Costly grace is the gospel which must be sought again and again and again. The gift which must be asked for. The door at which a man must knock. Such grace is costly because it calls us to follow. And it is grace because it calls us to follow Jesus Christ. It is costly because it cost a man his life. And it is grace because it gives a man the only true life. It is costly because it condemns sin. And it is grace because it justifies the sinner. Above all, it is costly because it cost God the life of his Son. You are bought at a price, the Bible says. And what has cost God much cannot be cheap for us. Above all, it is grace because God did not reckon his Son too dear a price to pay for our lives, but delivered him up for us. Costly grace is the incarnation of God, Jesus Christ coming to live with us." Now, this salvation that I'm talking about radically transforms the life of a believer. It radically transforms the worldview, and we start living for the kingdom and not for ourselves. Our lives are radically transformed, turned around. We begin to see things through the eyes and the lenses of the kingdom. If it's business that we are doing, if it is anything that we do it according to the standards of the kingdom. You get to a point where you are totally sold out for Christ. Friends, this is not easy. It is not easy. It demands sacrifice. It demands a constant fellowship with the King. This is a costly calling. That's why I repeat this morning, if it doesn't cost you, it is not worth it. David, in the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 24 and verse number 24, he says that he will not offer burnt offerings to the Lord his God, burnt offerings that cost him nothing. Now, yesterday, there's a clip that I watched. The voice from the background that is calling the name of different people, calling them with what they were called to do. And it goes something like this. For example, accountant James Imbo. And James Imbo walks to approach the throne of God. And when you look at my face, I am wondering, accountant James Imbo, who said that I am an accountant? I have been a pastor all the rest of my life. Of course, I walk with that, you know, that collar of a pastor. And I'm walking courageously. And I'm asking myself, why do they call me an accountant? And then that voice tells me that though you have spent the rest of your life being a pastor, pastoring a small church somewhere in the city, God did not call you to be a pastor. God called you to be an accountant. And the aim of you being an accountant was that you were to help the different churches in the city with their financial accounting. If you did that, then these churches would have reached out to millions and millions of people. And I'm there and I'm wondering. I was only pastoring a church that had a population of 1,000, and I was as faithful as I was able to. But there are millions of people that missed the opportunity for their lives to be transformed because I did not go in line with my call. And as I was reflecting on that, and I realized some of us, including me, we sometimes fail to do what God has called us to do because it is not comfortable. It is not what we would want to do. It is not in line with what we feel we should do. It is costly. It doesn't seem to pay well. It doesn't seem to augur well with what we feel should be done. If it doesn't cost you, it is not worth it. Now let's go back to the story of Abraham and Isaac. And this is a point in the life of Abraham when the heavens had opened. Isaac is born. What a joy. What an excitement. After 25 years of faithful waiting of, you know, for this boy to be born. This is an act of divine grace and the fulfillment of a very long-awaited promise that God had given. In chapter 21, verse number 1 to 2, after Isaac is born, the kind of statements that God, or that is indicated there, 21 verse 1 and 2, says, "And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken." A promise that has been delivered. A long-awaited divine appointment with God. And Isaac is named, you know, laughter. Isaac means laughter. In other words, Isaac was a source of joy. He was a source of delight. He was a source of wonder. A source of excitement. When Abraham sees his son Isaac, he remembers that God is a faithful God, a promise-keeping God. Then in the midst of that celebration and all that, God drops a bombshell. And he tells Abraham, "Abraham, what I want you to do, take your son, not Ishmael, but your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." Genesis chapter 22 and verse number 2. Now, I want you to imagine with me the kind of struggle that Abraham is going through. God himself promised. In fact, when he promised him, they laughed. They laughed that idea off. Oh, we are old, and how is it going to happen? But God insisted that your heir is not going to be this Ishmael or this Eliezer, your servant. But he is going to be your son, and his name is going to be Isaac. And then it comes to this point when now God tells him, that same son that I promised you and that I delivered to you, you are supposed to offer him, to kill him. I need him as a sacrifice, a burnt offering. And I want us to imagine, why do you think that was a very difficult test, a very severe test for Abraham? I want to suggest to us three reasons. One, the reason why it was a costly affair for Abraham is because there was a conflict between the love for his son and the love for God. We know, and it is no doubt, that Abraham loved his son so very much because of the reasons that I have given before. So he had to struggle between the desire to keep his son and enjoy him and see the promises of God, of the different offsprings that God was going to bless him with, come to pass. He had to struggle with that and the desire to obey God. Because God has given an instruction. And he's struggling. How will I obey God? And how will I show that I, how will I, you know, connect the two? The love for my son and the love of God and the desire to obey God. Isaac was a son that came after 25 years. He was the only hope that Abraham had. Isaac was the best thing that ever happened to Abraham. And then God himself, in verse number 2, as he was giving him the instruction, he emphasizes that this attachment was a strong one. He tells him, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love. So he tells him, you know, that gives us the kind of attachment that was there between Isaac and his father Abraham. And because of that anguish of loss, losing his son, the depth of the father's love was, you know, was able to be, I mean, the love of the father was able to be deepened because of the pain and the anguish of losing his son. This morning, I want to ask you, who is your Isaac? Is there something that is a source of your delight? Is there something that is a source of your joy? Something that you asked God for and waited for? And God is asking you right now to surrender it to him. Who is your Isaac? So there was a conflict between the love for God and the love for his son, Isaac. It was not a cheap thing. Secondly, there was a seeming conflict between God's goodness and the demand that he was putting on Abraham. Abraham knows very well that one of the moral principles of God is that no one should kill. The act of killing was against the moral principle of God. And Abraham has to struggle with this and is wondering, how is it that God, who does not want anyone to kill, still demands from me, my son, that I may kill him? So he had to struggle with that. But we realize that what God wanted was not a physical death per se. He wanted a spiritual sacrifice. God wanted Abraham's willingness to give back to God the most precious thing that the Lord ever gave to him, his beloved son. Now, is there anything that feels like it's not making sense when God asks for it, when God demands for it? I don't know whether you have been in that situation where you get to a point, you calculate all your income against expenditure, and you realize that for you to support this worthy cause, that's calling for financial commitment, either you'll have to forego other bills or adjust a number of things in your life. Have you ever been there where you feel, you know, God is demanding that I support that children's home with part of my income? And you compare your expenditure with what you have and you realize it doesn't just make sense. God wants me to sacrifice this, yet he's the same God who's given me in order for me to take care of my family or take care of myself. I know that cannot compare to the kind of conflict that was going on in Abraham's life. But that is kind of what he had to struggle with. And then finally, there was a conflict between the promise of God and the death of Isaac. You know, it is God who promised Abraham. And he told him, I am going to bless you with a son. And through this son, the world, the whole nations of the earth shall be blessed. All the offspring will come from Isaac. And then he gets to this point and it is God who is asking him to sacrifice the same son. Can you imagine that kind of conflict that was going on in Abraham's life? It wasn't adding up. It wasn't making sense for Abraham. Because if Abraham obeyed, it means that promise and all the hope that he had would be destroyed. The promise wouldn't come to pass. It wouldn't come true. Now, I want to ask you, have you ever gotten to such a point? For example, you pray to God for provision towards a certain project that you want to undertake. And you tell God, Father, I need 100,000 shillings. And God, in his own faithfulness, gives you 100,000. And immediately you receive the 100,000, you remember that the Bible says that all my tithes and this. And you're wondering, now, 100,000, that project needs 100,000. And if God wanted me to give 10%, siangeongeza, you know, 100,000 and something on top. But he gives you 100,000 and then he demands 10%. And you're like, that, you know, that can't be God's voice. Have you ever gotten to a point where you want to silence the voice of God? I have. You know, God is speaking something and I'm wondering, no, God, don't speak that right now. Please. And I tend to feel and think, maybe Abraham, he was struggling with that. Is that really the voice of God? And that's a conflict that is going was going on in Abraham's heart. The conflict between the promise and the new instruction that God is delivering here. But against all odds, this man Abraham obeyed God. It was a costly affair. It was a tough one. Now remember that God has called us to pay the cost in order to receive the benefits. God has called us to pay the cost in order to receive the benefits. If it is not costly, it is not worth it. Because Abraham paid the cost, he was able to receive the rewards of the benefits of paying the cost. And that's what I want us to look at right now. What are the benefits of paying the cost? What are the rewards of paying the cost? One, it leads to our faith being strengthened. Our faith is strengthened when we obey God. Now, Abraham's faith has always been strong, irrespective of the different challenges and the different circumstances that have shaken his faith. But Abraham's faith was strengthened until he got to a point where he believed that God was able to bring Isaac back to life. Because when he leaves his servants there, he tells them, we are going. You know, he's the one who received the instruction to go and offer his son as a burnt offering. And he knows very well that when God demands for a burnt offering, the best you will remain with his ashes. But he tells his servants, wait for me here. We are going to that mountain. And we are going to worship the Lord. But then we will come back to you. You know, that's the kind of faith that Abraham had. You know, he knew that even if God will ask for this son, and I will sacrifice him and I'll cut his neck, God is able to bring him back to life. That is the kind of faith, the level of faith that Abraham was able to grow into. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 19 talks about that. It tells us that Abraham believed that God was able to bring back Isaac to life. Now, when we are faced with the challenge to pay the cost through believing God, even in the toughest of trials, this is the promise that God gives to us, that through that test, our faith will be purified as gold. We will come out stronger. We will come out better. We will come out, you know, with a stronger faith. Our faith will be strengthened in the process. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 9 says that our faith will be as pure as gold after we have gone through challenges. The second thing that happens when we are willing to pay the cost is that we receive God's approval. We receive the approval of God. I want us to read some words that the angel of the Lord says to Abraham. And I think that is the turning point. Abraham gets to realize, so this is what God wanted. Verse number 12. He said, do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. Now this is the approval. For now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. He tells him now, I know that you fear God. That is the approval. I think that's the best thing that Abraham would have heard from God. Now I know. Now I am convinced that you fear God. So Abraham's obedience or faith was approved even without him killing his son. So it was not a physical sacrifice, as I had said earlier. It was a spiritual sacrifice. Because Abraham had done everything. He had done everything in readiness to sacrifice his son. And God looks at it, looked at his heart. In the spiritual arena, Abraham had already sacrificed his son. God accepted and approved Abraham. He says, "Now I know that you love me. Now I know that you fear me, because you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." So when we pay, we are ready and willing to pay the cost. Our faith will be approved of God. And which other best gift can we receive from God than our faith being approved? And God saying that, "Now I know, my son, my daughter, I know that you love me, you fear me, and you honor me." The third reward or benefit of paying or willing to pay the cost is that the sacrifice was returned, or the sacrifice will be returned. So God may return our sacrifice now or in the future, or he may as well replace it with a better sacrifice or something better. So God may ask us for other kinds of sacrifice. Many people have given up their careers or their business or their jobs for God and have found a better, fuller life in the work to which God has called them or has led them. We also need to remember that whatever we give to God, he wants us to give ourselves first, then invest our time, our talents, our possessions as he directs. And that's why Jesus says, the greatest commandment is that you give God your heart, love him with your heart. And I want to say this morning that God desires of our heart more than he desires of our service. God desires our heart more than he desires our hands. God desires that we give ourselves to him first, fully, before we give to him things, time, resources, and all our talents, our possessions. And that's why when Jesus was in the temple and people came giving, and we are told that there is this woman, this widow, who came with a few coins and dropped them in the offering basket. And as Jesus Christ looked into that, he says that this widow has given the best gift. It was not in terms of the quantity. It was in terms of the condition of the heart. She gave herself first. She said, "Lord, this is all that I have. I've given myself to you before I give my gift." 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 to 5. Who would want us to read that? Paul talks about a small, poor church in Macedonia. And he says that, "Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability," yes, and beyond their ability, "they were freely willing, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints." Verse 5. "And not only as we had hoped, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us by the will of God." They first of all gave themselves to God. And in the first service, I gave an illustration. And I asked, "Have you ever been in a relationship where you really don't love this person. But because you have plunged yourself into that relationship, you just have to maintain it. But your heart really is not in that relationship. I have been in one. I won't share with you the details. That one I will share in Man Enough class. But what happened, or what I realized, is that when I'm in that relationship, what I will do is that I will do all that I can in terms of giving. You know, a date here, a date there, a gift here, a gift there. It's not from my heart. Because by the end of the day, I will be complaining. Now, sasa nimepeana hii, you know, this lady is so demanding and all that. It was not from my heart. I want to use that gift to cover up. You know, to show that I really cherish this kind of relationship. And that is what happens when we don't love God, when we have not given ourselves to God. We will do things in order to cover up that, so that we show ourselves as people who have a love for God, but yet inside us, there is nothing. There is nothing. God expects us, or God desires of us, that we first give our hearts. We first give of ourselves, our love, before we even offer to Him whatever it is that we want to offer. And we need to realize that we cannot outgive God. Whatever we give, He will return to us. That sacrifice that Abraham gave his best, God was able to give the best, a better alternative. But he was approved of God. Finally, when we are willing to pay the cost, another benefit that we will receive is that we will know God better. It will lead us to knowing God deeper, knowing the ways of God. The Bible says that he showed Moses his ways, but for the children of Israel, he showed them his actions. When we are willing to sacrifice, when we are willing to pay the cost, we will know not just the acts of God, but the ways of God, the heart of God. We will be able to sense his heartbeat. So in the process of willing to sacrifice his own son, Abraham received a deeper insight into the ways of God. He learned that God is more interested in our inward attitudes than he is interested in our outward acts. He learned that total surrender to God and to his will is more important than the greatest sacrifice that we can offer to God. Abraham also learned that God himself supplies whatever he demands from us. Whatever God demands from you, he will supply. He is the one who supplied the ram that was used for the sacrifice. And when God demanded Isaac, it is God who promised and gave Isaac. So when God demands anything from us, may we be willing to give. May we be willing to surrender to him and say, Lord, you are the one who gives whatever you demand. I will surrender and give to whatever you want me to give. Whatever God wants us to surrender, whatever God wants us to sacrifice. And I promise it's going to be a costly sacrifice. It will cost you. But God will provide whatever he demands from you. The name of the place where the ram was provided was called the Lord will provide. The Lord will provide. Jehovah Jireh. I would like to end with some bold statements that Jesus made in the Gospels. Luke chapter 14, verse 25 to 33. Luke 14, verse 25. Now great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Verse number 30. Let me jump to verse number 33. So therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Luke chapter 9, verse 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another, "Follow me." But he replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go and say goodbye to my family." Now listen to what Jesus tells him. "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." No one who puts his hand to a plow and looks back is fit for the service in the kingdom of God. I want to end there. And in case you clearly heard God speak to you this morning, and you're wondering, how do I respond to the word of God? Maybe you heard the same way as Jesus Christ, the apostles, Peter, after the Pentecost day, Peter stood up and preached the word of God. And the Bible says that those guys who are listening to him, they heard that word cut through their hearts. And they asked, "What shall we do?" Maybe you're asking the same question. Maybe not with that kind of magnitude. But it is clear to you that God was speaking to you and you need to do something about it. This is what Peter said to them. And this is what I'm going to say to us this morning. This is what God is telling us. Repent and be baptized. And the baptism here is a change of heart and a change of direction. So repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So I come to a close. And I want to ask us, who is your Isaac? What is it that the Lord wants you to sacrifice? What is it that God wants you to give to him? And some of us, it might just be just a character. Or maybe just God wants us to go to the next level of sacrifice. Or maybe God wants us to get out of that place that feels comfortable. And many a times, even me, when God gives me a vision concerning ministry that is a bit uncomfortable, I tend to try to dodge and get back to that comfortable place where I feel, you know, I will not interfere with anyone. I will not have to pray so much. I will not have to, you know, to go an extra mile even in my spiritual walk with God. But God wants us to go an extra mile. And that's why he has brought us this word. And in our own individual areas of life, in our individual lives, in our own areas of ministry, in our own workplaces, in our neighborhoods, in our own families, our marriages, our relationships, I do not know what God wants you to sacrifice this morning. May God lead us and may God speak to us clearly what he wants us to do in response to that word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you've spoken to us and we have heard. Thank you, Lord, that your word does not come and go back void without accomplishing what it was meant to accomplish. Thank you for each one of us that has heard your word. And I know that there are hearts that are now being stirred up. And Lord, they are wondering, before I get out of this place, Lord, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? What is it? Who is my Isaac that I need to sacrifice that I may receive the benefits of living a costly life? What is it that you want me to do better or to stop doing that I may be able to get to the next level? Heavenly Father, I pray that those questions, you will answer them, Lord. May you settle them in the hearts of your people. May we see a transformation and a change, even the way we serve you, with our time, with our talents, with our gifts, with our possessions, with everything that you've given to us. I know it's not going to be easy, Lord. It wasn't easy for you to give us your son to die. And it's not going to be easy for us to live this life that cost Jesus his own life, that Jesus had to die on the cross. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be easy, Lord. And we thank you that you reminded us that you are with us. Even when you demand those heavy stuff, you demand those difficult things out of us. There are some of us here, young people, that God is demanding for your purity. And you're looking around and you're saying, it's not easy, God. How is it going to be? Everyone else is doing it. How is it going to be? But God is saying, if I demand that from you, I am going to give you the grace to stand in this generation. And there are some of us that God is demanding that we lay down our pride, that we may get to wash other people's feet. Father, we didn't realize that we were dealing with pride. We thought it is the trend of the generation that we are living in today. But today, Lord, you've spoken to us. You want to deal with that pride, Lord, that our marriages can be restored. Lord, you want to deal with that heart of pride, that our relationships can be restored. You want to deal with that pride, that we can walk in the ways that are pleasing to you. Can only imagine if Abraham got proud and say, this is my son, I've waited for 25 years, I can't give him, Lord, I can't offer him. Some of us, that's the attitude that we've been wearing. Many a times, Lord, you've spoken to me to begin something for the young people that will transform their lives. And I'm feeling like it is not easy, Lord. We don't have the resources here at Praise Chapel. Let us just do the normal meetings that we do. But Lord, you're saying, when I demand of you, James, I will do it. I will give you the grace to go ahead and do it. Lord, what is it that you demand from us? As a church family, you want to grow this church and you're telling us, get out of your comfort zones and go reach out. And we are saying, Lord, here in Kizingo, we have people who have very hard hearts. We can't reach out to them. You're telling us, I am the one who created those hearts. I can change them for my glory. Father, give us the grace to go out of our way and invite people not just to Praise Chapel, but to Christ. I pray that, Lord, there will be a radical, bold steps that we are going to make this morning and this day in response to what you have spoken to us. We want to receive all these benefits that come with boldly accepting the cost that comes with obeying you, O God. Heavenly Father, I have to admit this morning that this sermon, this word that you've spoken to us, was not an easy one to even understand. I struggled, Lord, even to come up with this sermon. But Lord, you assured me and you say, this is the word that you want us to hear today. Give us the grace, Father. Give us the grace to respond as you want us to respond. Each and every one of us, as we have heard your word, I pray, Lord, whatever we need to do, help us to do it, oh God. May we not fear what people will say about us. But I pray that there will be radical, bold steps to where you want us to go. There are people that God has been speaking to give part of their income, part of their salary, part of their money to a children's home somewhere that is struggling. And you're wondering, how is it going to be, God? I have so little money. How is it going to be? I want to encourage you and challenge you this morning. Would you please surrender to that voice that is nagging you every single day? God wants to use you. God wants to use you for His glory and for your good. Heavenly Father, as a church family, we ask you. We desire that this church will grow. We desire that we will see people come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I know that there are principles in the Bible that are not very comfortable for us, Lord, to begin practicing. But they are the principles that you have laid in your word. Give us the courage. I pray for Bishop. Give him the courage to step out and say that this is what we are going to do. This is what God is saying. We shall follow as a church family. Give us the grace, Father. Give us the grace, Lord. We thank you. We bless you. In that mood of reflection, maybe God has spoken directly to you and just clearly to you what you need to do. Maybe you're struggling with this idea and you're telling God, oh no. Maybe it's an idea that's going to turn your life around and turn the situations around you, things that are disturbing you, and you're wondering, why is this thing happening in my life, in my family? Maybe God is giving you an instruction right now. I want you to whisper a prayer to God and tell God, this is what I'm struggling with in my heart. Father, I want you to help me. I surrender to you, just as Abraham surrendered in the seed. Because the Lord has said it, it's so difficult, it's so hard. But I will do it. I will do it because you said it. Go ahead and whisper prayer to God in the next few minutes. Even as we come to a close this morning. God. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We have heard you speak. We need the grace. Just as you gave Abraham the grace to be able to respond in obedience, give us that grace. So we surrender to you that you may get us out of our comfort zones, that you may accomplish what you want us to accomplish. Thank you for speaking to us, Lord. Thank you that you are with us to help us accomplish that. The glory of your name. Amen. 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 I want to pray for anyone who desires to receive Jesus Christ in his life or in our life as Lord and Savior. You're here with us and you have never accepted Jesus Christ as Lord, and you want to accept Jesus today. If you could just raise up your hand wherever you are, you want to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior this morning. Okay. And lastly, I want to pray with you. If you specifically has heard God speak to you, and you're sure that that was the voice of God speaking to you on a very individual basis, I want to ask you to just shoot up your hand, and then I'm going to pray with you. God knows the desire of your heart, and there is something that God is nagging your heart to go and do, and it requires sacrifice. It requires you to pay the cost, and you want the help of God to be able to accomplish that. If you're there, I want you to just lift up your your hand. I will pray with you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for those hands. The Lord has seen it and is gonna respond. Let's just put our hands down as we pray together. Father, we thank you for those hands that have been raised up to you. This is a deep desire. Even the raising up of the hand itself is a sign of surrender. And saying that, Lord, you have spoken to me. I would like to respond. Though I do not know the way to, but I will surrender to you that you may use me for that purpose for which you want me to do. So I pray, Lord, for your grace over each and every person that have raised their hands. And even those who have not raised their hands and still grappling with those issues in their lives. And they're wondering, Lord, where do you want me? What do you want me to do? I pray that, Lord, you give them the grace to be able to respond in obedience to that word that you've spoken to them. May they be the agents that you're going to use to bring a transformation in that situation for the glory of your name. We thank you and we bless you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Kwa safari nimechagua, nisipokuwa na nguvu, niite, niongoze kwa neema. Kwa upole wako, hata nikikosea, nisaidie, nisaidie, natamani kutembea nawe. Natamani kutembea nawe. Natamani kutembea nawe. Niongoze, niongoze. Sielewi njia hii, ndio maana nakuhitaji, nakutegemea wewe, enda nami, enda nami. Nashindwa kukupa yote, hata hivyo nitaamini, kwani najua mwishowe kuna raha. Kutembea nawe,
natamani kutembea,
kutembea nawe,
natamani kutembea nawe. Niongoze, niongoze,
natamani
kutembea
nawe,
natamani,
natamani, Baba usiniache,
natamani kutembea nawe.
But for now,
this is what the Lord says. He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you go through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior.
Utaniacha, nataka niwe karibu na wewe. Yeah.